Hello, welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. I'm the RPG Chick, and we're continuing. It was unanimous. Last time all of you voted to enter the village, so we will do so. One of you stated with some trepidation, being the whole thing's abandoned, could be some kind of a trap. I share that trepidation, but let's see what happens. Hopefully they have a cure for our curse or something. Oh, you know what? Someone said, Colin the Baboon. You're so right. Was it Meerkat who said that? I'm not completely sure. Pray to lift curses. A prayer to your spirit will lift your curses, but after a prayer, your spirit will not hear you again for some time. Well, hopefully we'll be okay without the baboon spirit. Your spirit has heard you. You receive no further help for some time. You are on your own. Okay, we're on our own, guys. Still, everyone wanted to investigate the village. You walk into the village. Young hill dwellers pass you and stare at your strange clothes. You nod back, respectfully. I guess it isn't abandoned? Look at the people. Their own attire is rough by comparison to your gear. They wear their hair long but piled up on their heads. These people are ghastly poor. The village is like a ghost town, here on the knife edge of the backlands. Poor people. We can rest. Should we? Yeah, let's rest. And then we'll go mess with the alehouse. You stop a passerby and ask for an inn, and they lead you there directly. The woman who runs the place stands in a doorway with her arms folded. Are you from the king? She demands. You know what? These people have, they have issues with the king because they're poor. I know it. Sorry, just taking a drink here. Should I be honest and say I'm from the king? In which case they're going to address me with their concerns in one way or another. Could be bad or not so bad. Or I could just say, no, I'm a mere traveler. The fact that she went out and asked me, are you from the king, means she probably has an idea that I'm from the king. So if I tell her no, she might see through that lie. I am on a mission for the king. Taxes? She replies quickly. No. The woman narrows her eyes at you. This is a guest house, the best in Shamutanti. Only guests stay, and any guests of mine knows it costs me 3 gold pieces to host a traveler overnight, and 2 to feed them. But it's all between friends. Okay. Let's eat first. Food is just being served. Okay, not so much of a problem. I was really hesitant about that. The woman steps aside and you go inside and sit down. A few minutes later, her husband appears with a steaming pot of skunk bear stew. Yeah, I really want to eat that. As he sets down the urn, he catches your eye and immediately turns aside. For a brief moment, you feel you recognize him from somewhere. Let's try to remember then. These little inscribing's caught my eye. I don't know what that is, though. You rack your brains as the man hurries out of the room. You have an image of him, panting and wheezing, and holding up a hand for you to halt. It's not the old guy. Someone from today? I'd remember him if it was today. Memory can't be that bad. Someone from... I'm just picking one. Someone from Cantapani? Perhaps. But unless you saw his face at a window, he is not someone you met there. You wave the thought away. He is not a famous poisoner. That is all that matters. It is thick as mud and has a rich, disgusting flavor. You wolf it down all the same and leave your coins on a table. Do you want a room as well? The woman asks. Thank you, yes. Yeah, we're running out of money. The woman shows you upstairs to a room. There are three other guests already staying and asleep, so you settle quickly. The bed is not clean, but is comfortable. Did she say this is the best place? And after a long day and all its narrow escapes, you are grateful beyond measure for the rest. Oh, wait, I wanted to scroll, like, up. Oh, I pull it. The best in Shamutanti. And it's got a dirty bed. Sleep. Your dreams are vivid once again. You are walking, endlessly. The hills moving up and down under your feet like a rippling sea. Every step exhausts you, but no step moves you forwards. Meanwhile, a scorpion has crept into your gold pouch and is nestling down between the coins, ready to sting you when you next go to buy food. And in the distance, a deep voice is booming with laughter. The long, cruel fingers of one hand are curled around the metal frame of a crown, and with the other he beckons you forward as if into a trap. Great dream. Should we shake out our gold purse? Oh, I can't go here now? I want to go here now. Damn it. Well, it's important we got our rest, so I think out of the two I made the right choice. I would have still liked to go here, but I guess they're closed because it's morning, right? Beyond Shamutanti. You wake early and sit for a moment, in no great hurry to leave the village. This is now the third day of your journey, and the muscles in your legs are feeling lean and strong from so much walking. You spend a short while enjoying the peace, then unhurriedly collect your possessions and set off along the path. Shamutanti is surrounded by several miles of fields. It sits in a well-protected ring of hills and is close enough to the river to be reasonably prosperous. As you follow the path between lines of sun-baked crops, you come to a fork in the road. The right-hand way leads past a set of outbuildings, while the left leads directly off into the deep woodland. Between the buildings. Dumpus. I'm taking a meta approach right now. We could go straight there. This might be more dangerous anyway. But I do want to see what's around here, if there's anything at these little huts, or whatever these are, this mountain. Either way, it looks like we're going to end up in this Dumpus. Great name, huh? And then on to Shamutanti. The Bridge of Vancus. Ooh, abandoned mines. Okay. Let's go between the buildings, then. You glimpse a few people at work by the buildings. There will be precious little company on your journey, so you should take it while you can. Approaching a low wall, you see a blind beggar, sheltering in the shade with his hand held outstretched. He hears your approach and clicks his fingers. Alms, would you? For love of Sinla, alms. Look at him. The man is a sorry sight. He is skinny and sparsely clothed, and his eyes are painted with a dark dye to indicate his blindness for all to see. Please, mistress, I wouldn't ask if I didn't need to. Used to be a gaoler, see? I don't know how to say that. Now I don't. See? Please? What happened to you? Red eyes, he answers, and won't say any more. Not giving him food. I'll give him a coin. You place a coin in his outstretched hand. You are kind, traveler, the beggar says. He feels over the surface of the coin, then bites down on it. Why me? This is a gold piece. You are too generous to a poor, sightless beggar. You'll get me killed if anyone knows that I have it. The beggar beams up at you. Yeah, I didn't have any change, sorry. Look after yourself. You say, preparing to walk away. Wait, he calls. One moment, please. He begins to scrabble around, feeling over his body as if looking for holes. Eventually he cries, "Aha!" and pulls out a copper key, which he holds out to you. "What's that?" you ask cautiously. "Years ago I lived in Kare," he explains. "Kare was my home, and in the city port I watched over prisoners in the Gaol. Beware the red eyes in Kare, or my fate will befall you, and you'll be here with me, begging for your living." Beware the red eyes. And what is the key? What are the red eyes? "Pray you never find out," is his simple reply. "Listen to me. Kare is wary of strangers, but this key will help you if you be captured by red eyes. Trust all me." As the man talks, you step quickly out of the road as an ox cart whips past you, raising dust. It does not stop. Of course, I'm going to take the key. Put it safely into your pack. "Thank you," you say. Then move on. You follow the path away from the village for half the morning. The walk is easy. It feels as natural as breathing to have the road move beneath your feet. Hard to believe you trained for this journey for so long, now that you are on it. You climb a little, tracing the side of a group of trees until you meet a fork in the road. You could continue straight on and upwards, or turn west for a while. Where are we? Oh, we're still here. Oh, turn for the trees? Wait. No, I'm going to continue on. Straight on. Till morning. By the star. I forgot how that goes. Take the first star and straight on till morning, something like that. Follow the north star and straight on till morning. I believe that's it. You continue along the path, climbing. Your legs feel strong and lean. By the end of this journey, you'll be built like a mountain goat. The afternoon progresses. I don't know if I want to be built like a mountain goat. The afternoon progresses, long and easy. This place you are walking through seems thick with desolation, as if it were long ago abandoned. And then, as if to confirm your thought, you come across two enormous stone pillars, listing slightly on either side of the road. They form a gate, but the gate is three times the height of a man. Look them over. Peering closely, you make out the faded remains of carved characters in the old script L and K. The remnant of a spell of fortune, perhaps, or of binding for these now fallen stones. Ooh, can we find something like that? L and K? Oh, wait, I didn't want to hit that. I wanted... Oh, I can't access my spellbook? I should write them all down on a piece of paper. I only have the six big ones, or five big ones. And I don't have an L and K. L and K. Let's go through. There's nothing for it but to go forwards. Through the gate! Hey, guys. You step into the shadow of the enormous gate. The ruins of walls line the path either side, but these are walls built from blocks the size of ox carts. Centuries ago, this must have been the palace of a king 12 feet tall. Now it has been leveled, and the stones stolen for the field walls and foundations of the villages all around. Haunted by ghost giants, perhaps? Investigate the ruins. I have to look, you know. You take a moment to clamber out over the ruins and off the path until you are surrounded by waist-high grasses. The ground rises and falls sharply around the outlines of houses and buildings. You trace the line of a street, wide enough to run three carts abreast, that leads quickly downhill towards a forest. Once this place was rich and plentiful. What happened here to remove every last trace of these colossal people? Look inside a house. You stop by the edge of a house. The side wall only stands as high as your knees. Grass nods above it. Looking inside, you can make out the edges of a fireplace, the brick, the back wall, and an adjoining area. Perhaps a grain store or a bedroom. Let's search in the grass. I don't know why for, but I want to see. You take a few moments to search through the long grasses and find nothing until your hand closes on a clay pot near one wall. It is the shape of a wine jug, but about 3 times the usual size. Around the neck is a red stain. Wine, or maybe blood? It is impossible to tell. The base of the pot has been smashed away, perhaps by age. Perhaps there's someone unhappy with the contents. You leave the pot behind. Okay. Let's follow the street down. I want to investigate this. Want to see who used to live here. Must be giants. You follow the line of the street down the slope of the hill. The further you go from the path, the more overgrown the ruins become, and until you can barely make out their outlines at all. After a while, you are not following the street at all, but simply holding to the same line. You approach the edge of a thick woodland. Oh, we're back here where I can go into this woodland. No, we're going to turn back and climb. This is a mountain pass, I guess. The path crosses over a low broken wall and then rises sharply uphill through a pass. After a while, you see 2 cave mouths, one to the left of the path and another to the right. Oh, these choices. The left-hand path is traditionally danger. I'm curious, though, the right-hand cave. You pause at the mouth of the first cave and look inside. There's a faint whistling sound. The wind, perhaps? We're going in. You creep further in. Oh my. He used to live in those towns, didn't he? Then a few steps on, you stumble and fall, and as you do so, the whistling stops. To your horror, you realize what you have tripped over is a foot. A giant slowly rubs its eyes and gets to its feet. It hoists up a massive stone club. We cannot parley. Cast a spell. What am I going to cast? Zap. Hopefully it doesn't rebound and hit me. I don't have it. I don't have Z. Not seeing Z. Alright, I don't want to cast a fireball. I don't know how small this cave is. I mean, it's got to be pretty big because there's a giant in it, right? What the hell? He's big, so... Wait. Yeah, I'm not finding stuff. The only other idea I have is charm. I really don't want to fight this thing. He's big. He's mean. Like certain spells not available at certain times. Yeah, I'm gonna write all this stuff down. I have W. I guess this is all we have. Barrier? There's nothing available. Crap. I wish I could look at my book right now. Yeah. Wait, here's... Yeah, but there's no A. I don't know why I can't cast it, guys. I have 12 stamina. Use the stamina. I guess we're fighting? You draw your sword and get ready to defend yourself. Okay, it's been like 2 weeks since I've done this. I'm going to defend. With a roar that shakes the rock, the giant swings its club and comes for you, determined to crack open your bones. You raise your sword to cover your body. He raises his club defensively. You circle one another. He raises his club across his body defensively. I'm gonna do cut. Stealing your courage, you move in, aiming to trap the giant against the cave wall. Moving swiftly, you aim towards his heart. He flicks your attack neatly away with his club. He is left breathless, but otherwise unharmed. He beats his club against his palm, readying himself. Alright, I'm gonna defend. You drop down, protecting yourself. Just in time, the giant raises its club above its head and attempts to crush you in a single blow. You are just in time to roll to one side. His stupid eyes are watching you closely, not wanting to take a risk. Thrust is... Taking a chance, you move forwards. Moving quickly, you thrust a straight lunge to skewer his eye. Boy, getting vicious. The giant deflects as well as he can. He staggers against the cave wall, and the ground shakes. He's staggering. I can only cut right now. Taking a chance, you move forwards. Moving quickly, you thrust a straight lunge to skewer his eye. Oh wait, did that. I read that part. You strike again, readying a blow that could part stone. You hurtle forwards as the giant swings for your head. He tumbles to his knees, almost crushing you as he goes down. His eyes follow your movements cautiously. Sideswipe. We're almost like equal now in everything we're doing. You attempt an attack and suffer for it. The giant swipes for you with its club. Your own weak thrust is knocked aside. Knocked aside, you stagger backwards. Now let's defend. Ow. Expecting a storm, you raise your guard. As the giant jabs with its club, you step smartly aside. He lifts his club across his body. He's defending. This is the highest I can go. Cool. Oh, he's almost done for. Ridding yourself, you move in. Moving efficiently, you aim to skewer his ankle. The giant pushes your blow smartly away. The hill giant stumbles suddenly. He is weakening. His dim-witted eyes are watching you closely. I'm gonna defend this time. Damn it. You drop down, protecting yourself as the giant lunges. You turn the blow with your sword. You are mostly unhurt. Cut. Nice. Stealing your courage, you move forwards, preparing a swing that could cleave a tree trunk. Probably one of his legs. You charge for your opponent. The giant turns your swing easily away with his club. He is not touched by your blade. Guy's got no stamina, though. Should I defend or sideswipe? Let's defend. Oh, God. Ow. Expecting a storm, you raise your guard. Just in time, the giant hefts its club high and tries to squash you in a single stroke. You escape by a hair's breadth. His stupid eyes follow your movements. Yeah, as is taxing us. Taking a chance, you move in, mustering a blow that could part bone from bone. You lunge forward. The giant parries slowly. The giant's eyes are bloodshot, and he is moving much slower now. Oh, God. You spy an opening, but misjudge. The giant kicks out with one oversized foot. You are caught off balance. Much more of this, and he will be using your bones to pick his teeth. I feel like I should defend this time. Oh, my God. You drop down, protecting yourself as the giant jabs with his club. You parry neatly. You are largely unscathed. Please, just get rid of him. Damn! You muster your courage, but it fails. The giant kicks out with one oversized foot. Then the gigantic club catches you square on the side of the head. That cracking sound is your skull, splitting apart like a fruit. What's succumb? Try again? What's succumb? What's my fate? You've been killed in combat. R.I.P. Can I... Let's not go in there. Let's try the left-hand cave. Watch be another giant. The left-hand cave is a little wider at its mouth, but it is also not deep and appears to be empty. Rubble covers the floor, along with a few items that suggest someone lived here. A huge broken stool, a net with a wide mesh, and a large human-shaped skull the size of a dog. This place was clearly home to a giant. But it's... unless the same giant goes from cave to cave. Alright, let's see what's here. Still, by the look of the skull, it seems the giant is long gone, so it should be safe to look around. Look at the skull. Look at the net. I might be able to use that. You pick up the net. The squares are so large that a rabbit or deer would be able to run straight through, but they're small enough that they could catch an animal of about your size. Of course, you'd cut your way out of such a trap in a moment. Let's take it. You roll the net up and put it in your pack. Let's look at the skull. I had a nightmare, guys, that I was killed by a giant. Next, you turn your attention to the giant's skull. Oh, it's a giant skull. Oh, the skull was the size of a dog. I thought it meant the size of a dog's skull. There's no trace of flesh remaining on the bone, and the eye sockets are dull and empty. No one has lived in here for a long time. The top of the skull has been knocked about a bit. There's a crack in the top, and most of the teeth are missing. Don't we need giant's teeth for something? A spell. There are only two teeth left in the jaw. You use the tip of your sword to pry a couple giant's teeth free, and you slip them into your pack. Cool. I guess we can't look at the top of the skull anymore. Let's look at the stool. Finally, you look at the stool. It's made from the lower branches of an ash tree, braced together with joint pins the size of your forearm. And before the stool broke, it could probably have borne the weight of several cattle. But it's broken now and of no use to you, and there's no way you could carry it far. All right, so let's leave it here. You put the stool down. You've seen enough. You turn to leave the cave. Let's not go in the other cave. Carry on. I mean, I might have been able to defeat that guy if I was just, I guess, a little more cautious. Defended more? I'm not sure. You crest a rise, or you rise above the crest, and continue down the slope on the other side. You pass out through another gigantic gate and into a barren mountainside. Nowhere to go but Dumps. What a name. The path trips and slides down a steep, scree slope and then emerges onto a sudden plain, as if the forest had been scooped away by a gigantic hand. A river trickles thinly between short grasses, and by its banks stands a tiny village. I want to check the village. Last time you guys wanted to check out a village, so let's check out a village. Today has been mercifully short and uneventful, except for my, little psychic gleam of me being killed in a right-hand cave. You have made excellent progress. With a decent meal and a night's sleep, your next day will start auspiciously. So you begin the gentle climb down into the village. You follow the path down into the village, passing a sign which declares it to be Dumpus. The streets are thin and narrow, and the buildings have been set close together, as if trying to withstand a storm. There's a terrible smell hanging in the air. All in all, it seems an unpleasant place. Let's explore the town. Halfway along the track, you come across a couple of merchants' huts. You browse for items worth buying with your 10 gold pieces. Your attention is taken by a finely woven skull cap, a finely crafted sword, and a small bag of provisions. Examine the skull cap. You pick up the skull cap and turn it over. Stolen from a priest of Darulay, the merchant declares with pride. A fine piece of work. 4 gold pieces. It's almost half our money. You can tell from feel of the cloth it has no inherent magic, but it might be useful in spells. Can I try it on without peeing? You place it on your head, but feel nothing. You take it off again. I'm putting it back. It's almost half our money. You shake your head and place the skull cap back on the merchant's table. Now, I'm guessing if we defeated the giant, we might have got money, but... oh well. Examine the sword. Carefully, you lift the long sword from the table and swing it through the air. It cuts with a finely carved edge. A fine piece of work, I'm sure you agree, the merchant enthuses. 6 gold pieces. Nope, that's more than half our money. You return the sword to the merchant's table. Should I get provisions? Ah! You examine the bag of food. There was about enough to last 3 days. 6 gold pieces, the merchant says with a smile. Good for a traveler, I'm sure. I need more money. You return the bag to the merchant's table. 6 gold pieces is too much, you explain, despite the hard rumbling in your belly. Will I have rations? Am I hungry? You nod to the merchant. The merchant smiles. Is there anything else I can help you with? Is there any work to be had here? I need to earn some money. The merchant sizes you up. You look like a good worker to me. One of my friends needs some digging doing. I'm sure he would pay you and feed you for it. Digging what? You ask. The merchant shifts uncomfortably. Does it matter? You find out. He stares at you. So? He asks. He looks over the shoulder at the path. I'm going that way now myself. You coming? Yeah, let's do digging, I guess. We need money. I don't like having 10 gold when things cost 4 and 6 gold. He leads you to a house on the edge of the village and introduces you to the householder, a stout man who is probably incapable of lifting a spade, let alone digging with it. What is it you need doing? Cesspit, the man replies. Out back. Needs digging. How much? Well, the man replies, it's pretty urgent. The old one's overflowing. How much money, you demand? 3 gold pieces. Yeah, let's do it. I'll get started. Spades out back, he replies with a jerk of his thumb. You walk through the man's house into the back garden. The smell is terrible. The job is not just to dig a new cesspit, but to dig over the old one. And it's going to be several hours' work that'll probably take the whole night. You collect the spade, which stuck in the ground by the hole. I guess I could have quit out this way before. Thank you. Should I make myself bigger to do it? This is what we have that requires a giant's tooth. It will summon a new giant whom the caster may control. I should have gone into that other cave and cast this. I can't go back though. I hate that you can't go back though. That's a feather fall. This is a metal mine fog. Can't cast these. What's the giant? Make me into a giant. It'll make it a lot easier, I'm sure. Big. The only thing is, can I cast it? Well, I have the letter I need. B. I. G. The Notorious. You cast a spell and wait for it to take effect. Then you feel the spade turn from a heavy tool to a mere toothpick in your hand. As you swell to 3 times your normal size, you have the digging work done in barely any time. That's cool. Although, how am I really digging that quickly using something that's the size of a toothpick? Maybe I use my hands. Collect my pay. You go back into the house and collect your money. 3 gold pieces. The grateful householder also provides you with some food, as well as a space on the floor to rest for the remainder of the night. You settle down happily and are quickly asleep. Okay, so we won't be hungry anymore. You dream strange dreams as you sleep. It seems as though you wander through doors and hallways built 10-20 times your height. You're an insect, and the hills over which you walk are the follicles of hair on the shaved chin of a giant. Is this because I made myself bigger? Storms of hot, fetid breath seem to sweep across you, threatening to blow you down into hell. Overhead, you fancy you hear the flap of giant wings. The birdmen came from the crown. Perhaps before this journey is finished, they will come for you. Okay. I can't go back into town. And I can't go back to check out the cave. I don't imagine, no, that we'll have a chance to. I would definitely go down and cast that giant spell with the giant tooth. Who knows what kind of treasure he had. Well, let's leave Dumpus. You rise early, thank the householder, and head out into the street. Within a few moments of walking, you are out of Dumpus and back on the road. After another hour or so, the way branches, with one path heading up into the hills and the other turning downhill and along one side of a barren stony bridge. Is that a village you can make out on the top of the hill? It seems a lonely place for it. Guess some kind of bridge over there. I want to check out the village. Waiting for a good choice for you guys to vote on. That's why it's a little longer. The gentle upward slope becomes a steep climb and you are forced to rest several times. So far, you have been walking through the foothills. Now the journey will become more serious. When you finally reach the summit and can look out over a low plateau you have crested, you see the path runs through a small settlement of crudely fashioned huts with really old people or witches in it. There are villages out in the street talking and working. It seems a happy, bustling place. They don't look that happy to me. What? Watch? Why are we watching? You stay at... I'm just curious why there's a choice of that. You stay at your vantage point and watch a while longer to see if things change. After a while, you begin to notice something strange about the way the people in the village are moving. First, you notice one is limping, then another. Then you realize they are shuffling as they move. Some use sticks. One is even crawling. Watch more. I'm going to watch more. You stay hidden and watch for longer. After a while, you realize that whatever is happening in the village, it is desperate. There was no laughter, no joy. There was no trade or commerce. The women do not move about, walk about, and the men do not watch them. It's like a prison camp. I'd make this a choice, but I'm pretty sure most of you would say to stay away from this place, which I am going to do. Well, do they need help? You know what? Yeah, I'm going to make this the choice. Excuse me. Should we help these people? Which is, I'm assuming, why we'd go in there. There's no trade or commerce, so we can't really buy anything. Should we help these people? If we can, talk to them, find out what happened, or what's happening to them? Or should we get the heck out of Dodge? So yeah, post your comments below, let me know what you think I should do at this point. I am torn between getting the hell out of here, because I don't want to end up like them, or have them attack me or something, or whoever's imprisoning them to attack me, and trying to help them. We have a lot of stamina right now. We're like good. We're not cursed. So maybe we're in a position to help them. So guys, let me know. Stay away from this place, or go and visit these people. I look forward to seeing what you all have to say. Thanks so much for watching, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.